What's up, everybody? Welcome to another episode of the Masters of Sport. Earl is here trying to make me mad.
I already succeeded.
But he's going to fail.
I succeeded. Dame was legit mad at me earlier.
No, I don't think I've ever been mad at you.
That's weird. You're angry, too. Why would you?
Why wouldn't you be mad at me? For what?
Because I'm, like, irritating.
There's only been times where I've been like, really? Why'd you say that shit? Like, I think one time, and it was somebody else, like, you might have said something to someone else.
Oh, was I mean?
Maybe.
I don't know. Now I'm real curious. You got to remember and tell me.
But, like, I don't really get mad at, like.
I could have been mean to someone. I'm not nice sometimes.
I'm trying to think who I've actually been mad at recently. Really, dude, only, like, one or two people I've been like, dude, I'm actually pissed right now.
Man, I'm curious what I said.
That's going to bother you.
Nah, forget about it. Definitely will. I already forgot. I'm moving on. That's what happens when you're mentally strong.
Shit.
What, you find that funny? Dane, yes. Speaking of that, when was the time in your life when you wanted to quit? And Ooh. Not even you wanted to quit. You did quit. And why did you do it?
I quit when I was an in-school suspension monitor.
Oh, did you?
Yeah.
I feel like you're going to go into something funny here.
Well, I quit because I said to myself, when I can make more money running the gym, I'll quit. So I had that as my goal. And then I quit.
So that was like you were doing it and then...
Yeah, and then it...
That doesn't count as like quitting. I want something like where like you lost...
Okay, so the only other
like
time...
you mentally lost and you quit.
The only
oh,
other...
Oh, I know when. When Daru had you doing the 10-second sprints.
Yeah,
you quit.
I mentally... What, I think I could do that right now. If
okay.
I would do a good job because I'm in good shape right now.
Okay.
But my true point of quitting would have been my sophomore year of high school. I was big. Like, I had already... started football 2 years, freshman and sophomore year. Wrestling, I did really well. And I went out, you know, I've been playing baseball since I was like 5 or 6, and I was good. I was a good catcher. And I was like, dude, if they put me on the JV baseball team, I'm quitting and I'm going to throw. I was like, I had already made up that decision. And I told my dad, I was like, I'm going to quit if they put me on JV. Because I know I'm better. I'm the best catcher on this team. I know I'm better than Moyer. And they put me on JV, and they put Moyer behind catcher, and I quit, and I went over to throw. And Moyer got hurt like 3 games into the season.
I would love it if somehow there was a picture of Moyer that could be like posted right there on the YouTube,
Jason,
the audio
could
one.
Definitely do
that.
That
would be
he
stellar.
He could definitely pull that off.
The good thing
he's
is
he's not going to want to, but yeah. He could do it easily. Yeah.
It'd just
his
be
mom works with Moyer.
It'd be so funny.
Yeah. Well, and Facebook, to be fair. But, yeah. I quit.
He'd have no idea about this. Like, nah. Does he actually watch? He might.
He sort of follows me.
Oh.
But I quit baseball for sure.
That's funny.
To go throw.
I have no idea who this person is.
Yeah. I'm trying to think other. I never really quit a job. I think that's my downfall.
You don't quit? Sometimes you should quit?
I think, and Jason and I...
You're going to say that out loud? Say it out loud. Come on, Dane, say it.
Jason and I have
talked... Sometimes you should quit.
...about this, where he and I have this knack of being so stubborn and stupid. Maybe he's not as dumb as me. He's definitely...
Yeah, I wouldn't say either of you are stupid. I've definitely seen both of your stubborn sides.
We will just relentlessly do something until it's like we don't beat a dead horse. Like, we beat a dead horse, we carry the dead horse back to water, we beat it again. We carry it like
I was gonna say you would eat it then. Shit it out.
In the water.
And then make a point to like step in the shit and like rub it in.
I'm just so good at doing work over and like relentlessly until it works. Like, if you think about it, you can't, what is this saying? You can't fit a square peg into a round hole.
You could do it.
I can do it. Like, I will do it. I will prove to you, I will prove you wrong.
Wow.
But definitely the
baseball. It's a winner's mentality.
No, it's a stubborn, like, not learn from your and I'm not even saying learn from your mistakes. I'm saying my failure up until I'd say a year and a half, 2 years, probably 2 years ago, is that I never looked for ways to make things better. In my mind, it was always like, I got to learn from my failure, but I was not failing in my mind. So I wasn't learning from my failure because I wasn't failing in my mind.
And no one was there to teach you a better way.
Yeah, and I think that's the whole, it's not learn from your failures. I actually think that's stupid. I think it's, don't learn from your failure. Always look for a way to make it better. Like, that's like the better way to look at it.
That's how you learn from your failure. You see that didn't work. And you,
but I don't think it's a failure. I think it's better to look at it as though, like, there's other alternatives.
You don't see. There you go again. You're gonna make sure you're right, right? I get what you're saying.
Stick with me on this because it's a more positive way to look at it.
I agree with you.
Yeah. So screw you, you big bully.
I am not a big bully.
I'm mad at you.
You're the one who called me skinny fat before.
You are skinny fat.
See, there you go again. And I'm the bully. You're the one calling me names. You're body shaming me right now.
That's easy.
Oh, my God. Listen to you. Man, I'm going to go home and cry. Eat hash browns, loaded hash browns.
I love hash browns, dude.
Loaded hash browns?
Yeah.
Loaded vegan hash browns? What are you going to do? Well, actually, no. Probably be vegetarian.
Dude, hash browns are like hash browns and home fries. Those two are, I love.
Remember when I made you eat Govinda's down at Philly and you actually enjoyed it?
Yeah, it was good.
And you were like, I can't believe I enjoy these soy products. And I was like, yeah, because it tastes good. Get out of here with your nonsense.
Yeah.
You and the Liver King, you can go hang out.
Oh, God.
See, look, you can hang out with the Liver King. You can hang out with someone like, come on. Somebody, look at the way that guy looks.
Somebody posted in a bodybuilding forum, they posted their test levels, and it was like, their test levels were like 4,300. Like, I, you know, 10 times the level of normalcy. And they had all their levels, and they put it in, like, but they put in as a meme, and they circled, like, three numbers that any bodybuilder would look like and be like, this dude's on a cycle. And it says, like, Liver King's natural test levels after, like, drinking a liver shake. But they were, like, making fun of themselves, sort of, at the same time. It was funny.
I like that person, whoever they are. All right. So we talked about how you're a quitter. See, that was a genuine laugh, that one. Yeah. You thought that was funny.
Yeah, that was good.
All right. How did you then, or not just you, in general, how do you develop mental strength? Like, how do you get stronger? Don't answer this yet.
Okay.
You're going to answer it. I want to tell an anecdote about me. So I grew up in this tourist town, like where I was raised. In Pennsylvania. Jim Thorpe, yeah. It's where I was raised.
When are they going to change the name of that, by the way?
I don't know. I don't live there. I have family and
it's
stuff.
It's such a joke.
Let's just hope.
It's a nice town, too.
It's nice for a weekend.
It's a really nice place to go.
Yes.
I think four days, you got a really good family.
That's what happens when, you know, the whole architecture is from the richest people in the country, if you will, had houses there and had houses built.
I mean, that's where people go from New York City, Philadelphia.
You know, 150 years removed from that. And those houses are there, like, you have some, like, pricey architect, like, art. It looks nice.
It is a nice town.
It looks really nice, and they fixed it up. You know, there's good things to eat. There's enough to do.
Yeah.
But where there's the Packer mansions, right? Asa Packer, the guy who built Lehigh University, if you will. And then his son's mansion, the Harry Packer mansion. And they're on this hill. And if you go up that hill is where my dad still lives there. You go on up, whatever. Go say hi to him. He has a lot of guns. He'll love it. He's actually incredibly friendly. But that's like my big, right now I'm like, Dad, I was like, let's turn your house into an Airbnb.
That'd
like,
be awesome.
Come live with us for a weekend, like in the tourist season. Because it's like a beach town in that way. I was like, let's see how much money we make.
Especially
because
they're opening up more of the trails now, too.
He's like, I don't know. I can't do it. I'd have to get rid of all my guns. I was like, oh, man.
No, you just lock that door.
Oh, my goodness. Don't talk so reasonably to me because I've said this to him already.
Put a padlock on one door that no one can get into.
Yeah. We agree.
Yeah.
Anyway, this hill is steep. I mean, it's super steep. 10-year-old me made it a point I was going to ride my bike up that hill.
Oh, okay. This is great because I have very similar experiences.
10-year-old me said, you're going to ride it up the hill and you're not going to stop.
Yeah.
All right. I only had a BMX bike. I didn't have a gear bike. Yeah. So I had it was a single speed. And my legs were not strong enough to just keep pedaling through over and over again. So big brain move here. I found I could go side to side and sort of.
It's just like skiing.
Swing up and up.
Yeah.
And I could make it up the hill.
Yeah.
And I could do it. Got to the point I could do it four times in a day. Young kid, small town, I could ride my bike everywhere and anywhere.
You get to go down the hill too.
No, it was too scary. You'd have to, okay. Well, you could, but you'd have to brake and stuff. Yeah, it wasn't as much as zoom on down. I'd like to go more. I'd ride it out to the lake, out Monk Chunk.
Yeah.
And then ride in, because the whole thing was downhill for you were basically going downhill for 2-3 miles. That was fun.
That's fun, yeah.
There was a crew of us that would do this. Anyway, that is where I have decided I built my mental toughness.
That's
in
fair.
Physical senses, what you do physically, not necessarily emotionally or,
I
in other
physically,
ways.
Physically, though, it can transfer over to other areas.
It probably has.
Yeah.
But I wanted to share that story about
I think, and Jason could share, could tune in on this. There's a hill near where I grew up that when he would ride his bike to school, probably the same thing. This hill is it's just gradually gets longer and longer. And at the top, it gets steep.
Uh-huh.
And it's the same thought process and where you're just I've got to get through this. And the thing is that you couldn't, it's too narrow to go side to side.
Okay.
So it was one of those hills that for me growing up, my parents said, for you to get to ride your bike to school, you've got to be able to get up that hill by yourself. Because my dad, when you're 6 years old, my dad would push me. By the time I was, I don't know, I rode my bike in third grade to school. I was full steam. I would attack that hill and just hammer forward. So I think riding bikes for me was one thing. I do think wrestling had a big factor for me. And then just doing menial tasks around the house where my dad had a sign business and there were signposts and he'd say, I need 50 of these moved over here. Can you get them here? I'll give you $10. And it would take me 4 hours, but in my mind it was, that's what I was doing.
Nice. So. And that's how you developed your mental toughness?
I think
the groundwork for it.
I also think for me, swimming was a huge one. Because swimming, it's my mom would take me to the swim pool in the summertime. It'd be, from the time I was 5 years old till 14. And you go swim in the morning, it's 65, 70 degrees. It's 8 a.m. and you have to swim in a pool that's 69, 70 degrees. It's cold.
It's a wake-up call.
Yeah, and then you got to go in there.
It's definitely a rooster's crow.
Yeah, and on top of that, you have to swim for an hour plus and not talk to anybody and bitch about how cold you are. So I think swimming would be another
one.
Who
would you be without bitching,
Dude,
Dane?
The whole reason I stopped swimming was because I couldn't talk. I was like, Mom, why would I swim and play soccer when I could wrestle and play football and talk to people the whole time? I'm not going to do this.
You're a social animal. That's what you are. All right. So we're talking about mental strength today. How do you get that? How do you develop it? So what's, in your opinion, what's the best way to develop it?
So if I have a kid who struggles with it.
Yeah. How are you, what are some of the things you're trying to do to develop mental strength in an athlete?
Okay. So in an athlete, I think there's certain, there's a lot of things that I like to do. I like to give minimal feedback. I like to make something really, really challenging and just tell them to do it again and do it again.
What do you mean by making something really challenging? Give me a specific
example.
Very
good example. Today, these kids from Malvern Prep came up to the gym. So they did a little drop-in for the day. And they wanted to throw and lift. Their coach wanted them to throw and lift and be in the environment. So the one kid, I said to him, I'm like, dude, you're in ninth grade and you're small. You're just throwing for the first time. You should learn how to spin. And I could see by like his third, fourth rep, he did not want to spin. He wanted to go back to the glide. And I was like, nope, keep doing this, keep doing this, keep doing this, keep doing it. You'll figure it out. And like 35 reps in, he got one, but he was so defeated within like 5 to 10 reps. But then that persistence, it's like if you can just keep pulling them through that, that's a big wake up for them. And I actually asked after about 15 reps, I asked his coach, I was like, what's this kid's dad like? And he's like, dude, his dad is relentless. He's just so obnoxious, yells all the time. And like, it's important to know that because then I can give him a little more positive.
Because then you're not going to be.
Yeah, I don't want to do that. And so I think that it's finding things that are very challenging and making them repeat it over and over and over again. And then also giving them physical tasks, because now you're challenging them mentally and physically. But then the physical task would be like teaching them how to push with heavy weight, but then teaching them yesterday's football session. We did 4 triples as heavy as we could go. And they thought their drop set was going to be 70 kilo single leg back squat for sets of 10 on each leg. Nope. They had 2 options. They could do 1 set of 17 at the weight that I prescribed or 2 sets of 12. And so they would all get to like 10 and they were dying and they all wanted to do 12. But then after they did 12, I was like, dude, just keep like you got 5 more. Just suffer right now. It's going to be 5. It's going to end up being you're going to net 7 extra reps then. Like,
yeah,
because you're not doing that other set of 12. And so they all ended up going to 17. But they all thought they should have stopped at 12. Every single one. 9 of them.
Man.
So I think that's another example of like, look, we got to play the game. We've got to play the long game. And it's these micro wins that then, you know, kids like that train with me for 3-4 years, those tests lead to that mental.
Gotcha. Conscience. They get enough of them.
Yeah. And I think that's important. That's the best part about strength training. That's the best part about not doing trap bar deadlifts.
They may not necessarily listen to that episode. The incendiary episode where Dane fires all the flame. Yeah.
I have one more to add that goes back to that episode. And the only reason I brought that up in the previous episode is because Brian Seacrest had sent me some videos.
And we talked about the episode he's referring to. We talked about overrated exercises. Yeah. And
this exercise, I said, is underrated. Pin front squat. And I said, this is a movement that literally you do because you want kids that are like tough kids, like the kids that like usually football players, just obnoxious, right? They act like they're so tough.
Yeah.
Make them do pin front squats. So one, they're going to complain about their wrists on the rack, maybe a little bit about their shoulders. But two, they're going to get stupid lightheaded. And then you're going to be able to screw with them because some of them won't get lightheaded because they have a little more bulk on their shoulder. And some of them will get so lightheaded they're like blacking out in the middle of their lift. And I love doing like a low box. You know, you could just call it a pin front squat, but just below 90 degrees because it's horrible. Posture, everything.
It's rough on the upper back more than anything.
It's rough on your mind. It's just terrible.
If you can keep your upper back, they're not hard.
Yeah, they're
And the first rep's really bad.
Yeah, first rep's the worst.
After that.
So that's like another one. But I think it's mental toughness to me is just you got to be in the long haul.
It's a marathon.
Yeah, everything.
You know, everyone says weightlifting's like this rapid fire sport. Nah. It's straight up. It's the longest marathon probably you could think of. Yep. Like it's
absolutely.
I would say almost any sport to be legitimately good is a marathon.
Is a marathon for sure.
Without question. Like, dude, day in, day out,
make
it happen. All right. So what are there any other ways you challenge your mind? Like
I think you
use movements.
Yeah. You use movements.
You'll see frustration and you'll tell them to keep doing it.
Yeah. And like, I think that's like one thing I'm very good at is just like, okay, do it again. Yeah, no, that was better. Do it again. Okay. Yeah. You did this better. Good. Go again. You know, and then it's like, then you give them one big one and then they want to do it more. I think it's, I just think it's like, it's trying to find exercises and movements. Yeah, I mean, you know, there's some endurance stuff you can do, some sled work, you know, that are very challenging. That's where bodybuilding movements come into play.
Dude, okay.
There's stuff that we're doing every day with bodybuilding that you're just like, oh my God, this is hard.
So a lot of the stuff I'm hearing too is like when you were talking about the rep ranges, yeah, and now you're bringing up bodybuilding, which like, all right, we're going to, why is there this association with this like developing mental strength always comes into these long forms of like being under tension? Like the longer you're under tension, the stronger you become mentally.
I've always thought this, and this might get a little meta, is like,
oh, wait until you see my next question.
Oh, geez. Okay, so
it's not that big, but it's
but
silly.
Let's just use bodybuilding as an example. If I get on a dumbbell bench and I got to do, let's say, the 140s for a set of 10, and I immediately I drop them, and I got to pick up the 110s, and I got to do 10, and I got to pick up the 90s, and I got to do 10, and I got to pick up the 70s, and I got to go till failure. It's this really, really long, uncomfortable burn feeling of just horror. But you know there's an end in sight. But you're just so internally focused that, like, you're just feeling the groove. That's all you're doing is you're just moving. I got to get bigger for bodybuilding. And I think this big set, that big set feeling is easier to achieve earlier. And the carryover then is that when you get into that groove and you're just moving, now you learn long term, okay, now I got to do that for a shorter period with like a heavy back squat or a heavy front squat or a heavy bench, right? Heavy back squat is very mentally challenging. A lot of people don't even like to attempt it because they're scared. They go down in the hole, they'll just fail. This happens all the time. And it's normal. It's okay. But if you can get that feeling, which is easier to achieve with lighter weights, now you start to figure out, okay, I can get that feeling for a shorter time frame and back squat. And then now, okay, so both of those, you're under tension. Now the next lesson is how can you get that mindset to occur without physical duress? Like, so now how can I flip that so that when I'm going to attempt a snatch or a clean, or I'm a shot putter, I'm a wrestler, whatever, how can I get into that same mind, that same state of mind? How can I get into that state of mind when I go to do a clean?
I hear you.
And it's like learning it from bodybuilding, transferring it to the grind, transferring that to, you know, technique work. And then over time, it goes from this aggressive state of mind to a logic state of mind. So,
divorce of the emotions, if you will.
Yeah.
All right. This one's weird. It's not that jaw dropping. Is intelligence a form of mental strength?
Is intelligence.
Yeah.
How are we measuring intelligence?
Any way you want.
Body intelligence, mental intelligence.
We could say like a kinesthetic intelligence. We could say, I was thinking, because we're talking more mental, I was thinking more like smarts, if you will. And not necessarily, like, you could be book smart, you could be like musically smart, like intelligence, like some type of intelligence.
I think that's hard because I think it's like, I think it's a sign that you're, it can be a sign that you're tough. It's like, I mean, it would be, there's a sign that you're tough, but just because you're intelligent doesn't mean that you are mentally tough.
Yeah.
But in my mind, it's like, it's likely that you have mental toughness because you sit down and you're, I think one of the hard parts, okay, so to sort of go along with this, is that if you're intelligent, you're more open-minded to learning.
Uh-huh.
So to be open-minded to learning, you have to be mentally tough because you – and now there's some really, really bright people that are not as open-minded as I think they could be, but with learning concepts, they are.
Yeah.
And whatever that realm is. And so to be intelligent, you have to recognize, like, in whatever field you're in, that what you know is not the end-all be-all, that you're willing to go further to push yourself to be better.
Right.
Intelligence-wise.
All right.
So I think, yeah, to a point, yes.
Now, can intelligence be a weakness? from a mental toughness perspective.
Yes.
All right. Elaborate.
Okay, so if you have...
I thought you would like this one more.
Yeah, I think like... it's
there's
like,
a part of me that thinks you're thinking of athletes right now.
Yeah, I'm think. Well, I'm actually thinking about Harrison Morris, sadly. I'm thinking like...
He's going to be a doctor, isn't he, or something
like
that?
Yeah, something like that. But he's so bright that I think if he wasn't as bright as he is, he would have kept weightlifting.
Okay.
I also think there's other things that happened in his life that if he was a little bit less logical, he would have just rode out the storm a little longer. Because I think smart people can get out of storms quicker. So that can hinder their mental toughness. Whereas, like, dude, there's sometimes like you just gotta weather the storm.
So, like, he figured you're saying because he's so smart, he was able to figure out a good solution, and he was like,
"Yeah, I can leave this area right now."
Got
this,
in a better place, if you.
Yeah, for the time being.
Yeah,
I think, you know, and I'm not judging his.
Yeah, no,
it's. I think that there's. I think it definitely can though. I think that.
Could you say that an intelligent person might overthink stuff in a competition too? And
I think yes, and I also think the best athletes in the world are also extraordinarily intelligent. Perfect example: LeBron James. This is an anecdote that Taman and Noah were telling me about yesterday.
Like, I haven't seen Noah in a while. How's he doing?
He's okay.
He makes me laugh.
Yeah, he's a good guy. He's
super smart, and I like how he always pokes you.
Yeah, he's probably one of the.
But he doesn't get. I've never seen you get him riled up.
He gets riled up if I don't include him.
Oh, he wants a friend.
Yeah, so
you should include him.
He starts telling me about LeBron James is talking to one of his teammates who just got traded to him, and LeBron's telling him like, yeah, "You got to do X, Y, Z." Goes in depth. And there was like a meme going around of like, he's like nodding his head, okay, yeah, I'll do that. And as soon as LeBron walks away, he's like, what am I supposed to do? Like he's not on the level that LeBron's on. And I think, you know, and then Taman brought up Cooper Kupp, who was a wide receiver for the Rams. And he had a really big play in the Super Bowl. And they had an interview with him after the game. Like, how did you make that, you know, walk us through that pattern you ran for Stafford to hit you, throw TD. And he's like, well, they were showing cover three, but on his first two steps, I knew they were in cover two. So based off of cover two in that formation, and he just goes deep into how he read this, and he knew that Stafford would read this as well, and that the check down on that, based off of this read and this step, if he goes inside on cover two, even if he's showing cover three, means I cut to this route.
Yeah.
And he knew the ball would be there. And it's like they can see things so quickly and adapt in such
like
a
processing power.
Yeah, so fast. And it's like it's the same thing with the best wrestlers, best fighters in the world see that. They see things in slow motion, dude. And it's like it's a form of intelligence. It's actually a form of intelligence that I think that I believe is underrated, to go off of our previous episode. I believe that fighters, world-class athletes, give musicians that credit. Because they can hear music and be like, man,
right,
this is complicated. And I don't think that musicians do that enough in the opposite sense to
for the athletic
athletes.
Realm.
I think, it, you know, old school stereotype is that, like, jocks don't play music. They don't respect musicians. They beat up band guys. But I think that's long gone.
I think
gone.
That's more like a Hollywood stereotype.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, that's like the ogre character.
Yeah. Whereas,
like, where they would cast you now if you went out to Hollywood.
Whereas I think – to go into the best athletes in the world, I think they're bright. Like, dude. Usain Bolt could tell you how many steps it took him to run the 100.
Yeah.
And he would like he knew this.
There's almost what's the one analogy? You have like your frogs and your birds, if you will.
Yeah.
And the frogs are like your specialist, right? Like they're right up against the trees. They can see the individual tree, every little detail about it. I think some of the stuff you're getting into with like Usain Bolt, if you will, like with his steps, like that's a tree. It's like a frog type of intelligence, a very specific type of intelligence where the like Cooper Kupp one was more like a bird.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Like,
yep.
There was a lot of different inputs coming to see that and like make that cut there to know like, and then also too, there's like this emotional maturity that he knew his other person was just as capable.
Yep.
And there's like this trust there then too that goes on.
So I think going off of this in Confucianism.
Oh, are you going back to how you studied religion and and you have 2 degrees?
So in Confucianism, they talk about emotional intelligence, and I'm not using this words, but it's essentially like,
it's like knowing your triggers, right?
Yeah.
What makes you upset?
Well, and it's if something startling occurs, being able to respond at the same level is a very, it's a huge sign of intelligence, that can only be achieved later on in life, really. And like a good
Are
example.
Are you saying that all your emotional responses make you not that intelligent?
Correct.
Dean?
Yes. Yeah.
Wow. That was big of you. Huh?
Yeah.
Very mature. I think you're emotionally maturing now.
So a good, and this is what's funny is I go out this morning. We have this cat Pikachu, right? He was sick 2 weeks ago. I had to take him to the vet. And then I come out there this morning and he's like shaking. I'm like, dude, is Pikachu sick again? He comes out to start eating his food and he's limping. Dude, I think he broke his foot. His foot is like cracked off to the side and he's like limping on this. I'm like, oh my gosh. Now it's not horrible. It might heal, but I'm like, maybe I should take him to the vet. This is something I'm still struggling with. But
yeah.
My first reaction was like, oh my gosh. And I was like, blew it up. If I was like more intelligent, I would have, you know, processed it. And be like, okay, what do I do logically? Well, let's see what happens over the next day, and then I can make my decision. And I probably would just mention it to Caitlin and move on with my day.
Yeah.
And then come back, because cats are resilient, see how he heals. You know, we can figure it out. Where I'm going with that is that if I was in Cooper Kupp's scenario, I would be going, he's showing 3, maybe he's going 2. As soon as he makes his first step, I'm throwing everything out the window, and I don't even know what I'm running. Like, that's my intelligence in that scenario. And I think that's where it's like in everyday life, if you have intelligence, your ego exists further and further away from your reaction.
I gotcha.
That's what I think.
Man.
But right now, for me personally, my ego is like in my throat.
So
maybe a little lower.
How you were talking about Pikachu and the cat and the idea of a logical response. I was reading something today and they talked about logic and emotion. When you try to meet one with the other, will just ricochet.
Yeah.
It's like a positive magnet, and like it doesn't work. Like they're not going to come together. And they talked in the thing I was reading, they were saying, so when you are in the logical state of mind and you're met with an emotional something, you have to meet it with validation. Even if you don't agree, like instead of like, oh, you'll get over it. Like, yeah, it's upsetting when people leave you out, Noah.
Yeah.
You know what I like?
Yeah, that's fair.
You validate the feeling, if you will.
Right. Yep.
And to me, that's a form of like emotional intelligence. Like you can recognize they just want to be validated to get their, or if you validate their emotional state, it's easier to bring it down.
Yeah, that's very
where they
accurate.
Can become logical and deal with it. And I thought that was like,
it's funny because the Noah situation is it's literally relevant, and that would have been a really good. I actually struggled with how I should handle that scenario because I didn't include him in something that I knew I should have or I could have, but I wasn't sure if I should.
Yeah,
and I should have just said, "Hey, you know, I know, I validate it." And
it feels bad when you're left out. I get that.
I think the thing, my reaction to defend my reaction, I'm going back
there
to
you
my
go,
ego in my throat.
Yep, here you go. Shield up.
To Pikachu is that I felt for Pikachu. I felt the
empathy more.
Yeah, it was like, damn man, he's had a tough go of things right now. Like now he's got a, you know. Dude, this cat climbs trees. Like I've seen him. He probably fell from a tree from like 15 feet. Yeah. So that's what I was like, dude, he was probably playing. Pongo was chasing him and he fell out.
Man, that's rough. Speaking of empathy, another thing, this could just be like internet fact, even though I think it's probably like academic, some type of study fact.
Yeah.
They found that people who read more tend to be more empathetic. because they enter into more minds and ways of thinking stuff throughout their life, just through books, if you will.
Right.
And are able to have greater empathy then because of that.
Ah, maybe I should read more.
They can see more points. More. Stop just reading all those science stuff. What time? Oh, wow. I have like another thing about rising to the challenges for like mental toughness. So like, hey, you need to hit this lift to make this team.
Yeah.
Do you rise up? Do you shy away? Are you like incredible in training and you get on the platform and now you're a bundle of nerves and can't handle yourself? You go in the circle and you can't live up? Or are you more like Jordan and all of a sudden all your like you're already great and all your stats just get better?
Yeah, I think that that's – I think that one thing that Michael Jordan always talked about was like the number of shots that he missed to win games. Like he missed like – it was like 123 or something game-winning shots that he missed. But the reason why he had so many that he made was because he was prepared for those moments – from his misses. And I think that there's two. There's like some people who are just stone cold. Like they see it for what it is. It's a sport and it's not, you know, I'm doing this. I've put my time and effort into this because I love it and I'm just going to go perform. Like that's all they see it as. Logic is it's just a performance. But then there's other people who like there's other people who can rise to the occasion because that's how they're wired. Sam Mattis is one of those guys. And then there's other people that they know that because they've had such structure in their life leading to that moment that they see it logically, but they reaffirm themselves because of what they've done prior to that moment. So it's like a little bit of Jordan, a little bit of
of
you know, they're just gamers. But it's still like –
like video games?
No,
gamers?
Like gamers. Oh, as sorry. As in like they're going to perform so well. So I think it's like – it's like one of those three typically. I think about Haley actually and like, dude, she's had some moments where she's Clark the lift or whatever. But she's had other moments where she just sacks up because she knows she's capable of doing that based off of how much time and effort she's put into that development period.
Yeah. What was she front squatting today?
115 for 5 triples. That's a huge dude, that's a ton of volume at that weight.
Yeah.
Huge.
Why isn't she clean and jerking that yet?
I think she's going to. I really do. Nice. I think she's gonna at her next comp. I think it's gonna be over.
You're gonna get a monster one from her.
I think so. She's in such good shape.
When is her next comp?
July.
I know this is off. July.
Yeah. So
we are talking about mental toughness, and you just did bring up Clark and how other times she doesn't. So
yeah,
we're good.
Yeah. Yeah, it's true.
She more often than not
will make it
and goes for it.
Yeah.
And once the clean's on her chest, it's over.
Yeah.
Like it's 3 white lights.
I've only seen her get called or miss a jerk once in comp.
Really?
Like that when it was on the line. I've seen her miss I think 2 jerks total. One time she cleaned 103 and it was like her first time going big and she missed the jerk just a little bit.
I can't believe that. Yeah. I don't believe you.
But
you're
she
lying.
It was in San Diego at a competition in 2019.
You would know.
She had like 4 meets within a span of it was 4 meets in a span of like 8 weeks. Cause she was trying to make, I think she was trying to get ranked on the senior Pan Am team.
Okay.
Yeah. Anyway.
Do you want to talk about rituals? Do you think that's a form of mental strength?
I think rituals are like the best way to establish it because it just gets you to see things through processes and to zero yourself in and practicing the skill of not reacting and having rituals in place is like essentially therapy 101. You have to have a skill in place to handle your triggers. And if you can practice that over and over and over again, it makes life a lot easier. Like it just makes it easier to respond to in those hairy situations.
Gotcha. Man, I probably need a ritual for certain triggers. You got me thinking, Dane.
Well, I was thinking last night I went home, we had like, I don't know, 12 or 15 football guys up in the front room with me.
Wait, you're coaching football players again?
I gotta hate you.
Watch out, Tamon. He's coming for that.
You're trying to trigger me.
Yeah.
And And I was like, man, if this was last year, I would get so stressed, like just losing my mind. And if everybody wasn't on my level, I would be mad at them. And I've noticed that when I'm less stressed about it, everybody's on my level. Like, and the thing was last night.
So you figured out it was you were causing
yeah,
it a lot
sure.
of it. You were sort of like the I'm gonna say it, the wild card. Yeah.
And like last night, I didn't get stressed at all. And the whole session, it was just like everybody was just doing what they needed to do. And I'm like, man, I haven't been stressed in a training situation. Now, what's ironic is like these kids are all in high school. I am extraordinarily stressed by my throwers right now, like off the chart stressed by them, because for other reasons, and it partially I feel it is on me. So it's like
it's always your fault, Dane.
Yeah, where I'm going with that is I think rituals are good, and I think that we have to acknowledge triggers that and training a lot of kids in that situation was a trigger for me in the past.
Gotcha. You should start having all your throwers give you a hug before they throw.
I wouldn't mind that. I actually like old UFC fights. You could see, I mean, they still do this now. It's like when they go into the octagon, they like, it's like they embrace everybody. I don't mind stuff like that.
This one band I like, they do that before they go out on
stage.
Yeah,
I think that's
they'd
important.
Make it like every time before you have to, everyone had to hug everyone in the band.
Yeah.
So like everyone got five different hugs.
Yeah. I think that's good. I mean,
dude, you won't do it.
No, we do it at like the trials and stuff. If we're at like nationals or worlds, it's like, yo, dude, those are the hugs where you're like, those are legit. Those are the hugs that give me chills. Like I
nice.
Love. Yeah. Those like, you're at World Champs, you hug Sam. Dude, that's like a feeling that I'll remember for the rest of my life. That shit, I love that shit.
Congratulations. you good on your rituals? You want to go into these questions?
Yeah, let's get the questions.
Were you going to call them crappy questions?
No,
we don't even know what...
Questions.
Questions.
I was screwing up the...
You were giving me... Whatchamacallit? You were... I felt triggered. Not about anything you did. Something when I was younger. I could tell you that story sometime. I told it this weekend. All right. This is Reddit. You FrancoB97. FrancoB97. I have a doubt about... This is really long. There's like bullet points to this.
Bring it.
All right. I have a doubt about how to use and when one should use heart rate to improve their physical condition. At what time is it suitable? For example... In my case, I'm 24 years old. I stay healthy, and I trained almost every day in the gym, doing the typical strength exercises, many jumps, and throwing balls. But I know that my Achilles heel is cardio, so I seek to improve it. My idea is to do CrossFit and weightlifting for strength are sports that I like, and I have the idea of competing in them one day. So knowing that I'm a noob in the field of cardio, all right, here we go. What should I do? Do I do the CrossFit classes or do I add a chest strap to the WOD? Wow, man. That's a lot. I don't even know. Should he wear a weight vest to do CrossFit just starting?
No.
No. All right, good answer, Dane. Good answer.
Yeah, here's your answer. Once a week, ride the assault bike at 55 RPMs for 45 minutes. Once a week, do 20-minute intervals of 1 minute on, 30 seconds off for 20 minutes, and you have to keep it at 70 RPMs. And then the middle day of the week, you go 4 sets of 5-minute, as many calories as you can in 5 minutes. That's what you do. And in 8 weeks, you'll be better with your HRV or with your heart rate, and you'll recover better.
This is one thing I want to I feel, and I don't know if someone would back me up, maybe Matt Frazier's performance would. CrossFit is easier when you're stronger.
Yes.
And you'll be better if you focus on getting strong and technique.
Yeah.
Like how to do movements.
Yeah.
And I'm talking like the gymnastics stuff.
Yeah, and then that stuff, you'll pick that up in 8 weeks.
Yeah. Just get strong and mobile too.
Yeah, yeah.
Mobility helps. But like there's a reason why so many weightlifters go over and they're like, oh, I don't have to lift as much. And like, yeah. I'll just work on like the cardio.
The cardio side's so easy.
It's
to
like
pick
even
up
like
then.
Your boy Brent Fikowski, like one of his things was like, I have to get stronger shoulders. Like I have to get stronger, you know, and he had the cardio.
Right.
Because let's be honest, to succeed at
but
CrossFit.
But it took him 4 or 5 years to get the strength in.
Yeah. You need the cardio, but you need the strength too. Yeah. And if you don't have both, like you're not going to be at the top.
Yeah, I think that would be my answer for that guy.
Unless he's just trying to do it, but if you're trying to do a sport and compete, like, why aren't you aiming for the number one spot?
Yeah, I agree.
Speaking of anime from last time, too, have you ever seen Afro Samurai? My favorite part about it is the number one headband.
I'll have to look.
It's such an awesome concept. All right, this one's from the YouTube community. David Lausch. I want to say Lausch, but there's no C there. I passed my strength trainer exam, and I have my certification. Congratulations.
Good job, Dave.
What is it like to work in this profession in terms of day-to-day?
Horrible.
You love what you do. How much money should I expect to make starting out?
Not a lot.
You're going to lose money.
Yeah.
Unless you're working for someone else and they're paying you.
I mean, you're going to go work at a college where you're going to wake up at 4 a.m., go test the workouts, and then train the football team. You're going to make terrible money, and it's not going to be fun. You'll barely see the light of day. You'll work 12 hours a day and do everything that the head strength coach wants you to do. Or you could go work in a physical therapy center or a commercial gym where they play soft rock from the 70s and 80s that makes you depressed and decreases your testosterone.
Yacht rock.
Yeah. And, you know, it's like Jackson Brown on repeat. And you barely make money, but it'll be a little more sensible.
I hate it when the Spotify playlist starts repeating.
Oh, yeah. That's terrible.
You know, like, come on.
Yeah. You have
do something with your career. Curation skills of like what playlist you're choosing, please.
Pandora is way worse than Spotify with that.
Oh though. My goodness.
So I think the big expectation would be like you're not going to make a lot of money. You're going to have to work bad hours, and it's a fun job because you're in a gym all day. But like it the reward is going to happen later over time. Of you know, one of the things that DJ brought up was he was like, dude, like he had a good job making good money. Working in a corporate setting, like very comfortable.
Yeah.
He wasn't a millionaire, you know, but he's making enough money to for his life to be fulfilling for 30 years. And he said he sat there and he's like, dude, is this what I want to do till I retire? Like, am I going to just call it right now? I'm checking it in and I'm gone. And he's like, that's when I realized like working in a gym is so rewarding because you see such development with athletes and with kids and with people and all these things that can really impact them.
Especially in this gym too. There's big things that happen here and more than just a gym too.
Yeah. And it's like, it's figuring out the hard part as a strength coach is realizing like that's not coming unless you figure out the business side. And that's where it's a challenge. So there's a lot to learn. I would learn the strength and conditioning world first and then learn the business later, but it's just going to be hard.
Did you learn the business later?
Yeah. I learned the business 12 years later.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
At least when you learned, you learned fast.
Yo, you know what's crazy? I had these kids yesterday talking to me about this was part of the mental toughness was they were asking me about business questions yesterday while they were lifting. And it was interesting to see them starting to think because I talked to them about Mr. Beast and they were like, oh, wow, we never really thought about that. They just consume Mr. Beast.
Yeah.
They feed into the whole system. And so I was talking to them about that. And two of the kids didn't realize that we had a gym in a barn and a gym in a garage. And I was like, wait, you thought we've always been here? Yeah. How much does it cost to rent this place? It's like, dude, I own this building. Like, really? And it was funny for me that they had no idea of the history.
It's funny too, as an aside, me knowing and things you have shared that some people still think you're the garage.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
If you will.
Yeah. Like the old garage.
Yes.
Yeah.
Not like
this garage.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, that's funny.
You know what I'm talking yeah. about too. I'm not saying anything.
So does Jason, probably.
He's not paying attention anymore. Yeah. He's working.
Yeah, no, I think that's like that's a hard part to learn too. I think that's well there's two layers of that. The hard part to learn is that you don't know, like for me the hard part was learning the priority for where we're at in this stage of the existence of this institution, whatever you want to call it. The other hard part I have with that is learning, and this goes along with mental toughness, learning to stop caring about what your perception of other people is, what they're doing, what they're thinking, what they're judging you for. It's like learning to just not care about that.
Yeah.
And it's something that some days I'm good at and some days I'm not good at.
It's the hardest thing a person ever does to just be themselves, if you will.
Yes.
And it's not necessarily you, but like the company just being itself, what it is, what it does, how it does it, and not worrying about, as you said, what other people say or do.
Right.
Especially to the people. And at this point in life, it's usually the people you think the highest of.
Yeah. Yeah. That's where the struggle has been for me. But and it's like how you just put it. All of us, all of the humans behind it are over here for Garage Strength. Garage Strength is this entity that provides the best.
And there's
training.
Not a lot of us behind it.
No, no. but we're providing content and education. We're providing education that you can buy, programs that are the best, and equipment that pairs with that stuff. And that's along with what we do on site. That's this entity, and we just have to feed this because this is going to exist, and it doesn't have emotions and stuff.
Yeah, do you plan for centuries? Like,
I don't know.
You know my line from that movie. I love that thought.
So it's weird because I've said that to Caitlin, and then she says, "I think you plan for an exit strategy."
Oh,
but I'm like, what? 30 years from now? I have another exit strategy in my mind. That's it.
Like selling it? Is that the exit?
Well, yeah, but it's like, I don't know, you know?
Yeah. Man.
Go public.
Go public.
Go public with Garage Strength.
Dude, that'd be sick.
Is Rogue public?
Oh. WWE went public. Yeah. But that was.
Anyway, so mental toughness. I think the hard part is just mental toughness is like not caring unless it's what you care about. Like you've got your focus and your goals and your mindset. You've got to care about that.
That is one thing I love. I love watching my 7-year-old right now.
Yeah. And
in general, that age is
very
wonderful at that.
Yeah, and
then they break when they're teenagers.
Yeah, and it's, you know, where Lincoln is right now, Lincoln's like in between where like he's so naive in certain things that he still has that. But you can see he's also so getting jaded by, you know, existence that he's like becoming a teen. And I'm just seeing it happen that it's like it's hard as a parent,
right?
You want to make it easier for him, but at the same time, you can't.
Yeah, you got to let him do it.
Yeah.
All right, let's end on that. Bout of mental.
Later.